हेलो एवरीवन, दिस इज समीर मेथी, सीनियर लेक्चरर इन कंप्यूटर इंजीनियरिंग डिपार्टमेंट फ्रॉम प्रवीण पाटिल पॉलिटेक्निक। आई होप यू गाइस नो दैट वी हैव स्टार्टेड विद चैप्टर नंबर 3 ऑफ ACM एंड आई हैव ऑलरेडी डिक्लेयर्ड दैट चैप्टर 3 विल कंप्राइज ऑफ 3 वीडियोस। आई हैव ऑलरेडी अपलोडेड 2 वीडियोस फॉर द सेम एंड दिस इज द लास्ट पार्ट ऑफ चैप्टर 3। सो टुडे विल स्टार्ट विद इंट्रा डोमेन मल्टीकास्ट प्रोटोकॉल्स, अमंग देम DVMRP, that is Distance Vector Multicast Routing Protocol, is the first intra-domain multicast protocol. So starting with DVMRP, it is an internet routing protocol that provides an efficient mechanism for connectionless, that is wireless, packet delivery to a group of receivers or hosts. So we can see it uses internet for routing and it uses wireless or connectionless services, and at the same time sender is sending to a group of hosts, in the sense to many receivers. So one sender to many receivers, hence multicasting. It is a distributed protocol that dynamically generates IP multicast delivery trees using a technique known as reverse path multicasting. So trees are used using a technique known as reverse path multicasting. So that will be discussed exhaustively in the coming slide. DVMRP uses distance vector distributed routing algorithm in order to build per source group multicast delivery tree. So tree is created, that too source wise. So again, such point will also be discussed in the upcoming slide. Each router maintains a multicast routing table by exchanging distance vector information among them. So routing table information have to be exchanged among routers to make sure the router knows which are the intermediate routers to it. It constructs a source tree for each group using reverse path forwarding. So again, that will be discussed in the upcoming slide. Multiple routers on the same network uses lower metric or lower IP addresses. So in case if the path is longer and there is second path which is shorter, so shorter path will be used. So that is what they are trying to convey, that lower IP addresses or lower metric link is used. Once a tree is created, it is used to forward messages from source to all the receivers, and the last two point conveys that it uses flooding and pruning techniques. So now what is flooding and what is pruning, again we can discuss in this diagram. So this is the heart of DVMRP, where it is starting with reverse path broadcasting. So if you could see this diagram, there is one source denoted by dark yellow and there are two receivers denoted by light yellow, and there are intermediate routers in between. So it will start with source sending a packet to router A. Now router A will flood that packet to each or every intermediate router associated with it. Now how it knows about the intermediate routers? Because they exchange continuously routing information tables, right? So RA will flood the packets to RB, RC and RD. RB, RC and RD. Now RB has receiver connected to it, so it will be a part of a tree. So RA will be a part of a tree and RB will be a part of tree because RB is connected to the receiver. Now coming to RD and RC, now when the packet is traveling from RA to RC, now RC will again flood the packet to all the intermediate routers connected to it. RC will forward to RE, to RF and RD. But when it floods the packet to RD, it will discard, because there is one shorter path to reach from source to RD. That is, source to RA to RD is a shorter path, whereas a longer path is source to RA to RC and RD. So if you remember, it uses lower metric IP addresses, in the sense it discards longer paths and it takes shorter paths. So source to RA to RD will be the efficient path, whereas source to RA to RC to RD will be discarded. So RD will be pruned over here, RD will be disabled over here. So this is what pruning is all about, in case if it is taking longer paths or if it is not, if it doesn't have any connection with the receiver, so it has to be pruned, fine. So RC now will flood the packet to RE and RF. Now RF will be a path of a tree part of a tree, because RF is connected to the receiver. But RE and RG, they are not connected to receivers, so again they will be pruned. I hope all the points regarding DVMRP is clear. So this is RPB, that is reverse path broadcasting, because flooding is being managed by all the routers, one to all is broadcasting. Now in the second diagram we will go for RPM, that is reverse path multicasting. In that diagram we won't use RD, RE and RG, because they are not part of a tree. So you could see RD, RE and RG are not used to send a packet from source to receiver, hence it is known as reverse path multicasting, one to many and not one to all, which was preceded or which was demonstrated in the preceding diagram. So how the source will send the packet? From source to RA to RB and finally to the receiver one, from source to RA to RC to RF and finally to the receiver. So this is how DVMRP works. I hope the point is clear. Coming to the second multicasting protocol, we have multicast open shortest path first. I hope you guys remember what is open shortest path first. In case if there are two paths, for example, if the path A is of 10 meters and the path B is of 20 meters. So OSPF is being designed in such a way that it will naturally consider or select the path which is shortest, that it will use the 10 meter wala path. And in case if OSPF is combined with multicasting, then it is known as MOSPF, that is multicast open shortest path. So we could conclude that it is an extension of OSPF protocol. MOSPF provides the ability to forward multicasting packets from one IP network to another through various internet intermediate routers. MOSPF forwards a multicast packet on the basis of both packets source and destination. So source and destination distance has to be is being taken care by MOSPF, and the one which is smaller in path, that particular path is used. This protocol needs a new link state update packet. New link state update packet in the sense, every time a packet has to be updated about the router, which is the next link, which is the shortest link to reach from one router to other. So this updation of packets has to be done to make sure MOSPF works efficiently. Such a packet is called as group membership associate. In order to improve efficiency, the router calculates the shortest path trees when it receives a multicast packet by updating link state packets. And MOSPF is a data-driven protocol, and it uses Dijkstra's shortest path algorithm to obtain its shortest path tree. Dijkstra's is an algorithm which calculates shortest path, but we won't go into the detailed aspect of Dijkstra's algorithm because it is not there in a syllabus. But only the factual data has to be recorded or has to be kept in mind, that MOSPF uses Dijkstra's shortest path algorithm to obtain a shortest path tree. Now coming to the intra-domain routing protocol, which is also known as multicasting protocol. In multicasting protocol, we have two types of trees, source-based tree and group-shared tree. We have seen source-based tree, where every source is used to make a tree, and the one router which is not related to receiver or it is using longer paths, they should be pruned. That was source-based tree, fine. And we have group-shared tree as well. Source-based tree examples are MOSPF, DVMRP, which we have already covered. Next is PIM-DM, that is dense mode, and PIM-SM, that is sparse mode. And sparse mode is a part of group-shared tree. So coming to the last topic of this chapter, protocol-independent multicast. Now MOSPF was dependent on OSPF, DVMRP was dependent on routing information protocol, that is RIP. but this protocol is independent of any such preceding protocols. So it is known as protocol independent, and it uses multicasting. So protocol independent multicast. So it is a multicast routing protocol that runs over an existing unicast routing infrastructure. So it runs over an existing unicast routing infrastructure, in the sense PIM could work for both unicast as well as multicast. There are two main modes in PIM, that is protocol independent multicast. The one which is known as dense mode, and the other one is known as sparse mode. PIM must assume that all routers in the network are multicast enabled. Fine. So it could go, it is using a unicast routing infrastructure, and its assumption is that all the routers in the network are multicast enabled, in the sense it could work both for unicast as well as multicast. It is possible for a router to manage traffic for groups that are separately using either of these modes. So the router should support dense mode as well as sparse mode, and depending on the situation, it could use one of the modes. That is what they are trying to convey with that point. PIM dense mode builds source-based trees using flood and prune. I hope everyone knows what is source-based trees and flooding and pruning, and is intended for large multicast groups where most networks have a group members. So now it is using flooding and pruning. So flooding and pruning is one to all initially and one to many at the second diagram, if you remember that diagram, right? So it is inefficient. It is inefficient in the sense, even if there are routers that are not connected to receivers, which we have seen in broadcast, and that situation, it wastes our bandwidth. So dense mode is inefficient as compared to sparse mode. Now this disadvantage of dense mode is being eliminated by sparse mode. Sparse mode builds core based trees as well as source based trees with explicit joins. On a shorter note, how sparse mode works is, it sends the data to only that router which asks for it, and not to all the routers which was carried in dense mode. So in this way, sparse mode is much more efficient. So this was it regarding part 3, or the last part of chapter 3. I'll soon upload more practicals and upcoming chapters of ACN. Thank you for watching the video. Take care. Bye.